So let us begin with K. Chandrasekharan.
Yeah.
He built a mathematics institute here, I mean, a pretty good department. How did he manage to sort of do it? Because he started from zero.
Yeah, yeah. See, well, I joined in the year 1960, by which time Chandrasekharan had been around for 10 years or something.
Yeah.
During that time, he had made many changes in the way the School of Mathematics was being run. In fact, when he first joined, there was no School of Mathematics.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, he created the School of Mathematics. He essentially had to put up some kind of fight with Baba to be completely autonomous, to build a group in mathematics which will be completely autonomous and called the School of Mathematics. But, I mean, when I say put up a fight, it was probably not all that difficult. But anyway, Baba at some point agreed, and probably it was only in 59 or 60 that the School of Mathematics was created.
Mm-hmm.
Till that time, there's one faculty for the entire thing. And the way it was organized, the institute was organized, was every job was a 5-year contract. And at the end of 5 years, you have to decide whether you want to continue the contract or get your better, higher level job and things of that kind.
Mm.
And basically everything was decided by Baba, assisted by Chandrasekharan. Chandrasekharan, when I joined, was a professor. And soon after, he became what they call deputy director. But when I joined, I think he was a full professor. And there was the mathematics faculty consisted of himself and K.G. Ramanathan. And those days, the name faculty was reserved only for associate professors and above, as they called them. Because others were not called the faculty members, and they were not part of the decision-making apparatus. The decision-making was all done by the faculty, which is, in fact, when I joined, Ramanathan was not a professor, he was a reader. Professors and readers could be, readers are not automatically form part of the faculty, but can be inducted into the faculty. That will depend on the senior people. So when I joined, I think in mathematics, there's only one professor and only one faculty member, that was Chandrasekharan. But soon enough, Ramanathan joined him. And many decisions were taken, for mathematics, all decisions were taken by the faculty. And essentially, the director, which Baba, acted as a rubber stamp for whatever recommendations were made. But of course, the recommendations at the level of the professor have to be approved by the governing council. The rest of it, already the director was the approving authority, but at the level of associate professor, the council is good to the governing council. And the letters of appointment up to below the level of associate professor, it came from the registrar, but from associate professor onwards, it came from the director. That is the way it used to be in those days.
Mm-hmm.
And as I said, all decisions were in the hands of these. And there were no bureaucratic rules about criteria for any promotion. You have to have this, that. Such criteria were non-existent as far as I know. And essentially, Chandrasekharan for mathematics and Baba for physics took decisions as they thought fit.
Uh-huh.
And in fact, I can tell you the number of people who are, for example, there were people without a degree, without a PhD, who were made professors at the institute and went on to become senior professors in those days, which is unimaginable these days. It simply cannot be done.
Mm-hmm.
And other promotions were not dependent on, you didn't have to have a degree to have a first job. Now, for instance, if you want to become a fellow of the Tata Institute, you have to have a degree. You didn't have to have a degree. You could be made fellow without, in fact, I was made a fellow before I got my degree, for example. In fact, technically speaking, I was made an associate professor. My associate professorship came after my degree. But it came 6 months after my degree. Again, unthinkable these days.
Yeah, right, absolutely. I mean,
and what is more, the promotions were, in some sense, completely arbitrary, in the modern sense.
Right.
In the sense of, because I was given a promotion in 1963, and again a promotion in 64, and again a promotion in 66.
Mm-hmm.
Gap of 1 year and 2 years. Mm. Unthinkable. It won't happen these days.
Well, they don't meet the guidelines.
and my fourth promotion came in 1970, which will probably also violate the guidelines.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. 63, 64, 66 and 70.
Mm-hmm.
What were the positions, for curiosity?
Sorry?
What were these positions to which you were promoted?
In 63, what they called a research fellow, which has been abolished now, doesn't exist. Then in 64, I became a fellow. 66, I became an associate professor, double jump, unthinkable again.
Yeah.
There's a leadership in between. And then in 70, I became a full professor. And in fact, at 70, I became a professor for 4 years. And then Narasimhan called me and told me that they are promoting, gave me the letter. And then I added saying, I'm sorry it has come so late. again.
Yeah.
The kind of thing that unthinkable.
Yeah.
And you know, a number of people who were made associate professors under the age of 30. It was the rule rather than the exception.
Mm-hmm.
If you didn't get promoted by the age of before 30 in associate professors, chances are
promotion
never come. That was the kind of feeling that one had in those days.
By the way, surprisingly, this is quite parallel to what used to happen in Indian Statistical Institute. I mean, up to a point, 1970s, early 70s. That's exactly what the model was.
Early 70s, Patodi is the case.
Uh-huh.
Where, I mean, after me, the case where the person was promoted under 30 was that of Patodi.
Right.
I don't know about...
Parthasarathi?
Sorry?
Parthasarathi?
Parthasarathi and Gopal Prasad may have just crossed 30. I'm not sure.
Okay.
And till Chandrasekharan was here, he took all these decisions. Mm-hmm. My promotion came after Chandrasekharan left.
Mm-hmm.
Not my promotion to the faculty, but my promotion to research fellow and fellow both came when Chandrasekharan was the. Of course, Chandrasekharan did not know the kind of mathematics I was doing. He simply was relying upon his younger colleagues who knew the kind of mathematics I was doing.
Right.
And in his days, for instance, Raghavan Narasimhan was made a professor in 1960. And within 3 years or something, he became a full professor. That's the kind of thing that happened. And of course, 1960, he had actually, by the time, had proved a beautiful theorem, the embedding of open Riemann surfaces in C3. He had proved that theorem in 1960. And as I said, I learned a lot of mathematics from him, as well as C.P. Ramanujam. C.P. Ramanujam, again, was a case, he was a research fellow. And then suddenly, 2 years later, he was made full professor. He was made associate professor. It's a triple jump. There's a fellow reader, all those things were skipped. And in fact, what happened was this, some other people were promoted as fellows. And we were talking, and C.P. Ramanujam was not promoted as a fellow. Talking, it's very unfair that how come Ramanujam is not promoted, all these youngsters talking about their colleague. We are promoted, he is not promoted, it's not fair, and so on. 3 months later came the news that he's been promoted as associate professor. That was the kind of, you know, it was a very thrilling atmosphere altogether. All these things contribute to make it so much more attractive. But the hostel life was pretty awful. The creature comforts were probably pretty poor. And Chandrasekharan had a role in the institute as a whole also. I mean, to some extent, apparently he had some kind of, he was one person to whom Baba listened to some extent. And he, for example, it's around that time, in 62, is when this mural, Hussain's mural, which is selected and put up there, he was commissioned to do that mural. That was in 62. And there's a committee appointed to select a person to paint the mural. The committee extended its invitation to many artists in Bombay to present miniature models of what they would like to paint us. And they will select one. And that committee, there was a committee which was appointed. The committee, the only member from this institute was Chandrasekharan. The other three were, two of them were well-known art critics. The third, well, also probably had something to do with art and so on. She was, lady was a good friend of Baba's. And Mrs. Wadia was the name. She was also a member. And the only person from that attraction, Chandrasekharan. So Baba had great respect for Chandrasekharan, even in matters outside academics.
Right.
And he, in fact, he was also responsible for instance, for the colloquium. He was the chairman of the committee for the international. Every 4 years, the Tata Institute conducts a colloquium, and this was something which he started. In fact, he persuaded the International Mathematical Union to sponsor a 4-yearly event in India, in Bombay. under the auspices of the Tata Institute. Mm-hmm. He started it, and the first one was held in 56, the second one was 60. Mm-hmm. And the tradition, it goes on every 4 years to this day, we have this entire colloquium going on. And it's organized exactly as Chandrasekharan did it originally in 1956. There's no change. Right. He set the pattern. Mm-hmm. And he was an extraordinary man. He was able to persuade the International Mathematical Union to allow him to organize this in Tata Institute, which is only a fledgling institution. Mm-hmm. In 1956 is the first colloquium. At that time, it had exactly three faculty members, three members of the faculty. Chandrasekharan, Ramanathan, and D.D. Kosambi, the only three people. Mm-hmm. These are all they had to show, and they were, the International Mathematical Union was willing to let him organize an international colloquium every 4 years here. They were the sponsors. Mm-hmm. And that has been a very successful program over the years, without question. Some of the volumes which come out of these conferences are treasured as great contributions to mathematics the world over. Mm-hmm. So Chandrasekharan was responsible for that. And he also, during his tenure here, brought out the notebooks of Srinivasa Ramanujan. Mm-hmm. These were lying in the Madras University archives with no one bothering about them. Chandrasekharan's idea that it should be made available to the public. Mm-hmm. These were unpublished material of private workings of Ramanujan on mathematics. And he got the Tata Trust to fund. He talked to Baba, who talked to the Tata Trust, and they were willing to fund the production of this volume. Chandrasekharan spent a few years at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton after he took a degree in mathematics from Madras University. It is those 2 years he seemed to have come across a large number of great mathematicians whom he had impressed very favorably. Mm. And when he went back to the country, they were quite willing to support him in his efforts to promote mathematics in this country, which he did very effectively. He was a good mathematician, but not one of the outstanding ones, I wouldn't say that. I mean, he was a good mathematician, but somewhat still doing classical mathematics, whereas things had advanced a great deal and he was not very familiar with many things that's happening in modern mathematics. But he had excellent contacts with outstanding mathematicians whom he consulted on all important matters. Mm-hmm. And they were a great help. He was able to import many of them to come and give courses at the Tata Institute to his graduate students, who had been selected very carefully. Mm. They were not called students, but they were essentially that. And many of them came here, and he had persuaded Laurent Schwartz, who was one of the big names in mathematics of those days, and Ziegler, another man who's considered one of the greatest of the 20th century. These two people came here not just once, but came on several visits, which lasted 2 to 3 months each time. They came some 4 or 5 times, these people have come, both Laurent Schwartz. And then Schwartz also persuaded many of his students to visit here, students who had become faculty members. Mm. At that time, they were not that famous, but subsequently, after their visits here, they had become very famous. Mm. In the same league, they became in the same league as Schwartz and Ziegler, that kind of. Mm. They became that later, but as young people, they came here. Mm. And they were a big influence. In, most of them were French, and they were influenced a lot, the way the mathematics developed here. Mm. Because there were no graduate courses could be given by locals, because only two locals with any competence. So Chandrasekharan brought in these people and they gave regular graduate courses which lasted one semester, and people benefited from that. That is where people from here learnt a lot of current mathematics of those days.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So Chandrasekharan had played a very, very important role in developing mathematics here. On the other hand, of course, he was an autocrat and made sure that what he said was law. There's no question about him. And when he found some student not doing well, he was sacked summarily. There was no time given. In principle, you would expect any contract to be terminated only with notice.
Yeah.
Such things never happened in those days. Mm-hmm. I mean, if somebody had demanded notice, probably would have given, but people were sacked overnight. if the progress. Of course, people had a hint of what was coming, because there will be some, gossip in the corridor saying that Chandrasekharan thinks he's not doing well, etc. So there will be some notice of that kind, but nothing formal. People were sacked instantly. And some of those sackings were not always probably fair. Mm-hmm. But by and large, they were fair. Mm-hmm. The only thing is, they could have been softened a little bit by giving people a little more time and maybe some talking too would have, you know, some counseling would have helped, and so they could be retained, but that kind of thing didn't happen.
I mean, to a large extent, even in modern times, don't you think in many of the graduate schools, not just here in TIFR, but around the country, some of this counseling or something can actually help, I mean, when it comes to PhD students? That doesn't happen actually, almost everywhere. You know, if someone is not doing well, in principle, they are supposed to leave. I mean, of course, because of modern times, there are rules. You have to tell them in advance. But
right.
But they are asked to leave, generally speaking. I mean,
and in those days, there were no such rules.
Right. As a result, you could do it. Yeah.
There was certain arbitrariness and sometimes unfairness.
Yeah.
But by and large, it was not unfair.
Right.
And well, it's always a moot question. You know, you devise any system,
mm-hmm.
there will always be mavericks who will not fit into it,
mm-hmm.
and who probably had they been treated, they would have done better, and things that kind of will always be true.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I mean, it makes sense to have things like counseling,
mm-hmm.
but still there will be people
right
who will not who will be beyond this,
the usual.
Beyond the pale, so to speak.
But there is one thing I have always wanted to ask you. You talked about selecting only the very good students here at the Tata Institute, and therefore the numbers were not very big. As you know, there is the American model. Typically, a graduate school admits 20-25 students. By the time the 4 or 5 year tenure is over, only 5 or 6 of those students actually survive. I mean, finish their degree. And even among those 5 or 6 or whatever who finish their degree, because it's only a very internal kind of evaluation of the PhD thesis, the quality of the thesis, typically in the United States, even in the best of the department, I can say with some confidence, varies a lot. Whereas India has adopted a procedure, India as a whole, all the good institutes make sure that the PhD thesis that is produced in their institute is of a rather high quality. So, you know, this model of trying to kill yourself over ensuring that the quality is the very best versus saying that we will produce a lot and some among them will be anyway of high quality.
This is fine, but the problem is this, especially if you go back 50 years,
mm-hmm.
40, 50 years, the number, if a person did not do well here, suppose he wrote a marginal thesis, will he be able to find a position elsewhere? Will he be able to have a career
mm-hmm.
in research? It was not clear in those days.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So it became all the more important. Basically, you assume that the person who is going to finish his degree here will continue here, was the early in those days an assumption, which is probably true of a place like Statistical Institute also.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Okay, that
and
I never thought
this
of.
This aspect had to be taken into account, and in such a context, you do want a good thesis.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
A better thesis than run-of-the-mill thing.
Yeah, right.
That's one thing. And the other problem is that, you know, in some sense, the people who are running this place were young.
Mm-hmm.
And young people tend to have ambitions which are, you know, they think we can do this, we can get better things than this, why should we settle for this?
In fact,
if you ask me, I myself have been guilty of that,
uh-huh.
at least in one case, when a student had written up something and showed it to me, I told him that it was not worth publishing.
Mm-hmm.
The same thing was published by a student of Atiya 6 months later.
Yeah.
So it's also a matter of, you know, our inexperience in this matter also makes a difference.
Right.
And the other thing is that most of the institutions here are modeled on British institutions rather than American.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. That's the other
point. That's the other point. I mean, it was natural that we were modeled on British institutions.
Mm-hmm.
And even this place,
mm-hmm.
I mean, Baba, when he founded it, made it a mixture of Cambridge and the Institute for Advanced Study.
Right.
Institute for Advanced Study is not a normal graduate school.
Mm-hmm.
If you make a mix of that, clearly you end up expecting something very different from what will happen in a standard American university.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, this reminds me, there was a mathematician by name Katok, you might know the name.
Yeah.
And he originally came from Soviet Union.
Mm-hmm.
And I was once talking to him and told him that how a great school like Moscow has been destroyed because of all this movement of all that happened, the political happenings in the Soviet Union and so on. And then he said, you know, you talk of a great school. A place like Moscow was wonderful for a Kazna or a Margulis, but it's no good for an actual ordinary graduate student. A competent graduate student, it's no good. But in Americans, universities, they survive and do well later.
Exactly.
Doesn't happen in the, happen in the Soviet Union, is what he said.
That's true.
To some extent, that's the model we have also adopted.
Right.
I mean, and I always keep wondering whether, you know, this whole business of having many more mathematicians who can go and teach in colleges or whatever. See, the question you asked, the assumption was they will continue to be faculty here. Of course, in those days, that was a justifiable assumption. But today, there are many, many places
But
that one could get a degree.
I don't think these institutions continue to set the same standards. People do move out of here, get jobs elsewhere, go there, and things of that kind.
That's right.
There are jobs available.
Yeah.
Incidentally, in the old days, the Tata Institute was kind of anathema for many universities departments. They won't take people from the Tata Institute easily at all.
Right.
It's difficult to place them. So that's another reason why they continued here indefinitely.
Right.
If he was a good scholar and so on, it didn't seem right to ask him to go if he's not able to find a job
elsewhere. That, of course. Yes, yes.
The Tata Institute didn't have good public relations with other institutions in those days. Part of which was the responsibility of Chandrasekharan, who had a very, I mean, he had an attitude which was very negative towards universities. In some sense, he had very poor opinion of many faculty in the universities, which was probably justified. But even if you had such an opinion, you have to, if you want to interact with them, you have to conceal it and act properly, which he did not. And so that's part of the problem.
Yeah.
The same thing was true of Baba. Baba also had very poor opinion of many of the faculty in the universities, rightly so. But then, if you want to interact, you have to, if you want to do something for them, you have to have some sympathy.
Right.
Cannot do without it.